Hi, thanks for coming out. Whenever I give this presentation, I always preface by telling people I'm not an academic radiologist. I don't do research. I'm not an MR physicist. I don't know much about protocoling. So the first question, obviously, is why should you bother listening to a single word that I'm going to say? And the reason is, specifically for that reason, I use this technology because it works. I'm in a very small community hospital, 240 beds. We have one scanner. We can't afford the time to run test protocols. My referring doctors don't want to hear about the latest studies and the latest experimental technology. We use this technology because it works. And what I'm going to present in the next few minutes is basically our experience over the last few years, cases that have proven to myself and to my referring doctors that this non-contrast MRA using FBI technique is actually a robust technology that works. And it's had a major impact on our practice and on our patients' lives. These are not my patients. I mean, I wish they were, but I practice on the south side of Chicago, and for the most part, the only time my patients run is if they're being chased by the cops. By the same token, these are not my patients' arteries, and the reason that I'm showing these images is not to poke fun, but you're going to go to RSNA, you're going to see these wonderful posters, you're going to see these wonderful presentations, and you're going to see beautiful pictures like this, and you have to ask yourself, who were these studies done on? I mean, if you can only get images like this on a swimsuit model, it doesn't do me any good. I mean, my patients are not marathon runners. They're not triathletes. The last time I looked, drinking, smoking, and eating were not Olympic sports. I need to know that this technology works on real people with real disease, the elderly, the diabetics, the obese. And again, what I'm going to show you is proof for me and my referring doctors that that is the case. Why is gadolinium no longer your best friend? I can't believe that in 2012 I'm standing here and nobody's invented a contrast agent we can inject yet into the human body to visualize veins that won't, you know, hurt the kidneys or kill the patient. It's mind-boggling. But Toshiba kind of went one step further. They just decided, let's just take contrast out of the equation altogether. Gadolinium, you know, MRI used to be kind of like Mikey from the old Life cereal commercials. Like, give it to MRI, they'll eat anything. You know, patient has contrast allergy, no problem. Patients on dialysis, no problem. Patients in renal failure, no problem. But now, in this day and age, we have this thing called NSF that reared its ugly head. And now we have this orphaned patient population. They're not on dialysis yet, so they can't get a CTA. They can't get a regular angiogram. You know, they have impaired renal function, and they're kind of in this nether region now, and they just couldn't get contrast. Now, I'm not an expert on NSF, and I'm not going to waste everybody's time going through all this. We're not 100% sure what the cause of NSF is. You know, gadolinium's been implicated, multi-dose gadolinium's been implicated, at least some degree of underlying renal function's been implicated. There really is no effective treatment. Here, a history of hypertension, diabetes. Again, I'm not going to bore you with all these. The bottom line is, it's a devastating condition, it's incurable, and it's avoidable. And in this country, for the malpractice attorneys, that's the trifecta. So if you can do a study that avoids contrast injecting altogether, I mean, to me, that's just absolutely incredible. I get really excited when I give this talk, because I'm a vascular imager. I want to see patients' arteries. And if I can do that without injecting any contrast, that's like somebody coming out with a cheeseburger that you can eat and not gain weight. And, you know, we've already seen, there are less than 500 cases in the registry, so it's not a very common condition. But the bottom line is, if it happens, it's an absolute disaster. But I like to think of NSF kind of like the UFO or Bigfoot or my wife admitting she's right, my brother-in-law picking up the tab at dinner. It's something I am never going to see in my lifetime. So why is it so important? Because from a vascular imaging standpoint, it thrust us back into the dark ages. And for a while, we were forced to rely solely on duplex Doppler. And don't get me wrong, that's a great technology. It's an excellent screening tool. It's non-invasive. It's relatively inexpensive. You can do it in a doctor's office. You can do it in the ER. But you don't get really any anatomic detail. Now, I go to the SIR, and a lot of people have studies that show, you know, wonderful anatomic detail, but, you know, we can't spend 3 hours imaging somebody under ultrasound. And the other thing is that it tells you a bit about the physiology, but not much about the anatomy. And the big thing is for me that a monophasic waveform in the common femoral artery doesn't tell me anything about the level or the extent of the disease. Here's a patient that we did a while back. They have a very simple, we call task A lesion, very short segment iliac lesion here. Here's their Doppler, monophasic waveform. Oh, here's another guy. His entire iliac system is occluded. He does reconstitute down here. It's on a slightly later image, which I just don't have here. Same thing. He has a monophasic waveform. I have no idea, based on Doppler alone, what the overall anatomy is. And that really impacts me from a diagnostic and a treatment standpoint. Nobody in this day and age is doing diagnostic peripheral angiography anymore. We want as much anatomic information as we can get before we bring the patient in the lab and start sticking needles into their arteries. So again, you know, it impacts my approach, whether I'm going to come from this side or whether I'm going to come from this side. And without knowing exactly what the anatomy of those iliac arteries is, I'm basically flying blind. I may wind up bringing a patient in, sticking them on one side, only to find out I have to stick them on the other side. And that's really, that's a travesty, because now you have somebody with two holes in, on either side. I work in a very small community hospital. I don't have a king's ransom of stents and balloons on my shelves. They're very cheap in this day and age. So having the anatomy ahead of time, you know, lets me prepare, lets me order what I need to order. So for me, non-gadolinium MRA really, without getting overly dramatic, really is nothing short of the holy grail for vascular imaging. We're getting this wonderful anatomic detail without injecting any contrast whatsoever. I consider myself a vascular imager. My job is to image somebody from the aorta all the way down to the feet without killing them, putting them in renal failure, or doing something bad. I insist for my technologists that they at least give me the aorta, the iliacs, and the femorals. If they can get me down to the feet, that's just gravy. Because the bottom line is, if I need to see the foot, I can do a contrast injection, 8 cc's of contrast. Nobody's going into renal failure from that. So as much information as I can get beforehand without injecting contrast, the better. There are a lot of benefits of non-GAD MRA. Fewer trips to the hospital and fewer needle sticks for the patients. My patients have jobs. They have to come one day to get their labs drawn, then they have to come another day to get the study done. It's 2 needle sticks. It's also cheaper to do non-GAD injecting. If 10,000 doctors across the country sent 2 patients a week for an entire year for non-GAD instead and GAD, we'd save the system $300 million a year. It's not going to cure the woes of what we've gotten ourselves into, but it's a start. No risk of allergic reaction. I'm a radiologist. Nobody's injecting me with anything unless absolutely necessary. For the hospitals and the doctors, you have a very unique tool that you can market to your referring doctors. We have an ability to image all of your patients, regardless of their renal function, regardless of their allergy status. And for me, this is a huge one. Shorter interpretation time versus CT angiography. Don't get me wrong. CT angiograms give us wonderful images. You know, once you plow through the calcium and everything, these are really wonderful pictures. Once I finish going over all these images and I think I can sit back and relax because I'm done, hell no. I have an entire CT of the abdomen and pelvis that I have to read. And the plaintiff's attorney is not going to care one bit that this study was done for vascular imaging. I'm responsible for every lymph node, every liver lesion, everything in the everything. So if I can get away without having to look at all this stuff, even better. FBI imaging, which we do, is also excellent for slow flow. Here's actually a case that we had just the other day. This is a patient with a known popliteal aneurysm on the left side. They had a CT angiogram. You can see here on the MIP coronal reconstructed images, it really looks like there's a total occlusion here at the level of the aneurysm with nothing distally. One of my partners happened to be standing right behind the technologist when they were doing the study. They said, image him again, image again. So they scanned quickly again, and you can see here's contrast filling the aneurysm, here's contrast coming down the popliteal. This guy wasn't occluded on that side. It's just that the scanners have gotten so fast now that they can outstrip the bolus. And here was a guy I was going to tell the referring doctor had a complete occlusion when in fact he did not. Now, had the technologist just done the study and then called us up and said, we're done, it would have been too late. But my partner happened to be standing right there, and this, we were able to salvage the case. Non-GAD MRA, same thing. Here we go. Looks like the patient's completely occluded on the right side without any significant distal reconstitution. It makes a huge difference for the surgeon if they don't have a distal target to jump to. This was done a couple years ago, and what we wound up doing was a time of flight image. We could have just adjusted the spoil gradient and redone it using FBI technique and saved 9 minutes off the scan, 12 minutes as opposed to 3. But again, excellent for detecting slow flow. This patient does, in fact, reconstitute a distal superficial femoral artery, has halfway decent runoff, and this patient is a candidate for a bypass instead of an amputation. At my hospital, doesn't matter what the patient's creatinine, if it's 0.5 or 5, we do all of our peripheral runoffs without gadolinium. We have not found that gadolinium adds anything other than cost and time and inconvenience. Again, I'm not a physicist. I don't understand most of this slide here, but suffice it to say that in diastole, the arteries and the veins are both bright. Systole, because the arterial flow doesn't see the refocusing pulse, you basically get low signal there. You do a subtraction image and boom, that's how we get our images. Here, early on, we kind of fudged this one a little bit, so you can see it was done at the wrong time of the cardiac cycle. Bright blood in the cava and in the aorta, this is the way it's supposed to look. These are cardiac gated, so there are some limitations. If patients are arrhythmic, it's not going to work. If they're, you know, super tachycardic, it becomes a little bit difficult, but we can kind of work around it. But we have had to cancel studies because patients had arrhythmias. But here, I mean, this is just absolutely beautiful. I'm going to use the words one-to-one correlation a lot because that's what I need, and that's what I needed to show my doctors in the very beginning, that we had great one-to-one correlation between the MRA and the standard angiogram. This slide means nothing to me. This may as well be in Sanskrit. These are the protocols that we use. And one time somebody asked me, you know, what is our protocol? So I included this slide so that they could take a picture of it and take it home. Bottom line is... This is for a Toshiba Atlas scanner, 1.5 Tesla at my hospital. You plug these numbers into some other company scanner, I have no idea what's going to happen. So take this for what it's worth. It is a pretty impressive looking slide, though. So let me just show you a few cases, just kind of our experience over the last couple years. Case number, and again, in the beginning, all these patients were done because their creatinine was elevated. Today, they're getting done, you know, non-GAD regardless. So here we have a 68-year-old female, smoker, hypertensive, diabetic. That's going to be a recurring theme. Serum creatinine of 1.9. Here we have just, again, this beautiful image of the aorta, the iliacs, the femorals. And here we can see the lesion right here. Here it is on angiography. I mean, just look at this one. This is just an amazing slide. Posterior tibial dominant runoff. Here you can see the perineal artery here with the perineal perforators at the level of the talus. The anterior tibial artery is occluded, but you can see these tiny little wispy collaterals. Plasty, dissection, stent. She did great. Used 15 cc's of contrast dilute when we did the actual plasty, but we knew everything we needed to going into that. The size of the vessel, the location of the vessel, how to plan it, how to treat it. Case number two, again, hypertensive, smoker, right leg claudication, serum creatinine 2.2. This was earlier on. We weren't doing too well with our stations, but you can see here, one lesion here, second lesion here, first lesion here, second lesion here. Again, great runoff, wonderful one-to-one correlation. Plasty, dissection, stent. Patient did wonderfully. Case number three, smoker, claudicator. The non-invasive showed no evidence for inflow disease on either side, so I'm not going to show you normal aorta and iliacs. This case just illustrates how important it is for us to have the anatomic information before we started. And again, this patient had no alternatives. Nobody was giving him gadolinium and nobody was giving him iodine. You can see right up here, there's a critical stenosis of the proximal SFA. This is at a level that we would normally just blindly park our wire during the case because it's high enough up. We weren't anticipating this. If we had done that, we potentially could have dissected this artery, occluded this artery, and turned somebody who's a claudicator into somebody with a severe life-threatening limb who may have had to go to surgery. But with this imaging that we had, we knew exactly where the lesion was, how high up it was, and we were very conservative where we put our wire when we started. Again, just wonderful correlation, all three vessels patent at the origin here, plasty, stent, patient did great. This is a patient who earlier on, she had a normal creatinine, but she was kind of contrast phobic. She'd read a lot of stuff on the internet. She didn't want any contrast injected. So we did her without contrast back then. Here we have, you know, kind of a slender aorta, very mild narrowing of the iliacs bilaterally. Looks like kind of a critical stenosis here at the common femoral. We weren't 100% sure what was going on here. We have obvious signal loss there. Thought, well, she probably just had diffuse plaque. Excellent runoff, really. Her problem is in the iliacs, which is very common in female smokers. Three-vessel runoff. Here we have, again, this is one of my favorite slides. I mean, just the one-to-one correlation here, again, beautifully shown this very, very mild narrowing of the common iliacs. You can see here she does, in fact, have a critical stenosis right here in the common femoral and does, in fact, have long segment narrowing. I mean, this, again, was one of my all-time favorite slides. I thought, you know, I surprised my... surprised the wife for the anniversary last year. It didn't go over too well, but, I mean, come on. Beautiful kids, beautiful angiogram, but anyway, had to take it down. So again, one-to-one correlation, just showing the beautiful anatomy on the angiogram and on the non-GAD MRA, all the way down to the feet. Dominant posterior tibial runoff bilaterally, beautifully shown on the angiogram, dominant posterior tibial runoff bilaterally. 82-year-old woman, history of coronary artery disease, dementia. She comes in with serious ischemic changes in the right foot. The Doppler suggested disease everywhere. She has kind of a slender aorta. She has kind of diffuse narrowing in the iliacs bilaterally with some more significant stenoses bilaterally. Right SFA not looking too bad, some diffuse disease on the left. Here's where the trouble really starts. Her distal SFA is just diffusely diseased, and she essentially has nothing going to the foot. By this time, my referring vascular surgeon was comfortable and confident in the MRAs that he did not ask for a conventional angiogram. So we saved this patient the added pain of having to go through an angiogram when there'd be nothing to do anyway, because I know that the angiogram is going to show exactly this. And unfortunately, she wound up with an amputation. This is a case, again, that thank God my referring doctors believe in this technology. This is a 60-year-old guy with alcoholic liver disease. He came in with bilateral claudication and relatively severe thrombocytopenia, 110,000 platelets. His INR was 1.7. So he comes in, dense plaque in the common femoral arteries bilaterally. Decent runoff, femorals look pretty good, trifurcations look good. He does have a little plaque there. So we basically told the surgeon, he's got bilateral common femoral artery disease. You send him for a little endarterectomy, a little patchplasty, goes on his merry way. Well, he went on his merry way, and he didn't follow up. Comes back a year and a half later, worsening symptoms bilaterally. Now his platelets are down to 38,000. His INR is 2.8. We decided to repeat the whole time I knew this guy was in the ER, I was just absolutely freaking out, waiting for the surgeon to ask me to do an angiogram on this guy, because I knew I couldn't go in either femoral artery because there's too much plaque there, and this is not a guy that I want to go into his brachial artery. He's thrombocytopenic, his coags are off the charts. I puncture his arm to do a diagnostic angiogram, and this guy's going to wind up with a compartment syndrome, and he's going to wind up in surgery. Thank God, again, our referring doctors believe in this technology and how valid it is, and you can see he's progressed this disease. Common femoral is now completely out. This side's pretty much stable, and he essentially has no runoff down that one side. He went for an intraoperative bypass. They did not ask me for the angiogram. They did an intraoperative angiogram, and it basically showed exactly what that MRA showed. Case number 7, diabetic, non-healing ulcers on both feet, non-invasive, no fempop disease. Again, just to show that even in people with severe inflow disease, we can get these wonderful pictures. I mean, you cannot get better one-to-one correlation than that. Other foot, same patient, other side. Again, single vessel runoff via diseased peroneal artery, depicted there and depicted there. Here's, a 75-year-old guy. This gentleman was in such horrible pain. It took so many tries on the MR scanner to actually get any decent imaging. This is an ugly image. I'll be the first to admit it. This is ugly. But you know what? It got the job done. I knew exactly where his disease was. I got enough information to be able to measure his vessels and know which side to approach him from. He had no other alternatives. Nobody was giving that guy contrast with a GFR of 31. He had enough problems as it is. Essentially, no flow down the right leg. Again, the angiogram, this isn't even a very pretty image. But we were able to order the stents that we need. We brought him in. We stented him. We did this whole thing with about 35 cc's of contrast. His creatinine didn't bump, and his symptoms got remarkably better. Severe claudicator, again, kind of, you know, general diffuse disease. The reason I like to show this is, again, it let me know what I was getting into before I started the case. She has a very angulated aorta, but I was prepared for it, and I knew exactly what catheter to choose before we started. Single little focal stenosis right there, beautifully documented on the angiogram. She was plastied. Again, she's moving a lot, but we get the same, you know, this really nice image down to the foot. Last two cases, here's a guy who comes in on an ultrasound, is found to have this big AAA, but he's not getting contrast. His creatinine's too high. Surgeons want to know what his anatomy is before they take him to surgery. Beautiful MRA. They see exactly how long the neck is between the renal arteries and the aneurysm. They know his iliac anatomy. They know his femoral anatomy. This is one of these orphaned patients who, you know, in the years past would have had no alternative other than to risk going into renal failure from contrast. And just last case here, again, just to drive the point home, that even in patients with horrible inflow disease, we can still see all the way down to the foot. I want to thank you for your time and just remind everybody that this technology is real. It doesn't just belong in the exhibit hall. It's really impacted my practice and my patients as well. And I just want to thank you for your time.